Because of this degradation, the S26 Ultra should not be a dollar costlier, despite purported enhancements. A better display, a faster charging battery, a slimmer body, and an Exynos chipset. Faster, higher, stronger is the Olympic Games motto, but these days, the smartphone Olympics could embrace the ever slightly faster, theoretically higher, marginally stronger phrase, if brands want to be honest and truthful about it. Meaningful, impactful year-on-year advancements appear unachievable in the current reality, and that's wonderful, honestly. Cell phones have gotten crazy good and capable. That's called plateauing, and it happens to everything and everybody at a moment. Just ask any bodybuilder at your local gym. What really grinds my nuts, however, is when brands proclaim their latest gen devices as some tremendous enhancement over the prior generation. Maybe I'm being cynical about it, but I can't help but sneer at it most times. Every once in a while, we receive substantial advancements, but are we going to get them with the Samsung Galaxy S26 Ultra? Additionally, importantly, will we have to cough up additional hard-earned dollar for the S26 Ultra? And now comes the part where I lay out my argument on why the next Ultra by Samsung shouldn't cost a dollar over the $1,299 price tag. The rumors I stated above are regarding TSMC, the world's largest and most advanced semiconductor foundry, headquartered in Taiwan. So TSMC has apparently hiked the cost of its third generation 3M wafers, and that could soon translate to more expensive smartphones. According to local estimates, MediaTek is paying roughly 24% more, while Qualcomm faces a 16% hike for chips made on TSMC N3P process. These extra expenses are expected to be carried down the line, meaning phones like Samsung S26 series or Vivo X300, which could use the new chips, could come with higher price tags. By the way, Apple is also supposed to be paying the increased wafer price, but since it builds its own semiconductors and isn't reliant on third-party designers like Qualcomm or MediaTek, the influence on iPhone cost may be less direct. I'm mentioning Apple for a reason here. I'm wondering if Samsung can pull off the same stunt. Is Exynos really back in the game? There's a nasty rumor going around suggesting the Galaxy S26 Ultra would ditch Qualcomm's Snapdragon 8 Gen 5, the Snapdragon 8 Elite successor, for the in-house built Exynos 2600. As I've mentioned before, Samsung will have a hard time convincing anybody that the Galaxy S26 Ultra with Exynos 2600 is wonderful, and it has to do with Exynos history. Samsung's in-house CPUs have lagged in speed and often struggled with heat, driving tech-savvy users to select the Snapdragon versions of its devices instead. As you know, Samsung often equips its Galaxy phones with either a Snapdragon or an Exynos chip, depending on the country where they're sold. But what if the Exynos 2600 is outstanding and heads in the right direction? The future processor is rumored to be developed using Samsung Foundry's 2-nanometer gate-all-around transistors process, potentially making it the first smartphone chip at that scale, ahead of competitors who are still on 3M. A lower number is often viewed as better. Early speculations claim a 10-core CPU paired with an Eclipse 960 GPU, which may surpass the Snapdragon 8 Elite's Adreno 830 by roughly 15%. Improved heat management is also predicted, which might enhance performance and efficiency. Overall, the Exynos 2600 is prepared to help Samsung narrow the gap with Qualcomm's high-end chips. On paper, it sounds very great, but I still think that Samsung will struggle to convince the majority of consumers that it's a capable Snapdragon rival. And that's precisely why the S26 Ultra shouldn't cost a dollar over the $1,299 price tag. Exynos 2600 should be cheaper to build compared to the Snapdragon chips of Qualcomm. Several advancements are promised for the S26 Ultra. It's up to you to determine if they're what you genuinely need, not want, but need. An improvement to the wired charging speed from 45 watt to 60 watt is expected. While not as quick as other competitors supporting 100 watt or more, this improvement could lower the 5000 milliamps battery charge time to under an hour. Wireless charging may remain at 15 watt. the phone could boast a brighter and thinner 6.89-inch OLED display using Samsung's latest M14 technology. This should improve brightness, reduce power usage, and increase screen lifespan. Additionally, color filter on encapsulation technology may be employed for clearer colors and smaller screens. Rumors also mention Flex Magic Pixel technology, which alters pixels for viewing angles and privacy. The main camera is likely to gain a new 200 megapixels to capture more light and natural bokeh. The ultra-wide and telephoto cameras may remain comparable, while a 50 megapixels 4x zoom and better f1.4 lens are possible. The S26 Ultra may remain similar to the S25 Ultra's flat-sided, rounded corner form, but could be somewhat smaller by roughly 0.4 millimeters. Not worth the hassle, but there you go. Personally, my biggest disappointment is the battery capacity, since the S26 Ultra could have traded the thickness for some extra 700 to 800 milliamps of battery capacity. The phone will come with a fantastic camera setup, it'll come with an amazing display, the S24 Ultra has it too, and it'll feel sleek and premium. But that's about it. $1,300 is a lot as it is. So a slightly brighter OLED display, 60-watt charging speeds, a considerably slimmer chassis, and a creative feature here and there. Paired with an in-house built chipset like the Exynos 2600, which could turn out to be amazing, don't get me wrong. I just happen to think that many will perceive it as a degradation. Samsung really shouldn't push the $1,300 envelope further. But if Sammy decides to hike costs, I can already hear the marketing mantras about the S26 Ultra being more premium than ever, with a revolutionary display and super fast charging speeds. A report reveals why some S26 models could see a price bump. TSMC has boosted its wafer prices for the foundry's third generation process node. The TSMC is now manufacturing its cutting-edge application processors using its third generation 3-nanometer process node. It's the same process node utilized by the world's largest foundry to create the Apple A19 and A19 chipsets that power the new iPhone 17 series. The TSMC will also utilize the same process node to create additional application processors for high-end phones such as Qualcomm's Snapdragon 8 Elite 5 and MediaTek Dimensity 9500. A fresh story in the China Times, a daily Chinese language newspaper, says that Qualcomm and MediaTek are paying TSMC extra for the silicon wafers used in the foundry's N3P process. The publication indicates that MediaTek and Qualcomm are paying 24% more and 16% more to TSMC, respectively. It isn't clear whether such increases are comparable to TSMC's second generation 3-nanometer node, which was used to create Qualcomm's Snapdragon 8 Elite and MediaTek's Dimensity 9400 application processors. Since they have to pay TSMC the higher prices, Qualcomm and MediaTek will most certainly charge their customers more for their processors, which is why you might see Samsung upping its pricing for some of the phones in the Galaxy S26 series next year. The Vivo X300, rumored to be powered by the Dimensity 9500 application processors, might potentially wind up with a price rise. If you're wondering whether Apple paid the increased price for the 3-nanometer wafers, the China Times report implied that it did. However, since Apple designs its own application processors, it doesn't have to pay a chip designer like Qualcomm and MediaTek. An entire rung is eliminated, which implies that unlike phone makers like Samsung and Vivo, Apple simply pays TSMC. The third generation 3-nanometer chipsets are predicted to give a 5% performance gain at the same power consumption and a 5% to 10% savings in energy consumption at the same frequency. In a nutshell, as the process node shrinks, so does the size of the transistors employed in the component. This results in a higher transistor density, which measures how many millions of transistors are shoehorned into a chip per square millimeter. The transistor density number is a highly important figure. The higher the number, the more powerful and energy efficient a chip is. Expect significantly higher chip pricing next year. Things could become worse next year when the foundry launches production of application processors using its 2-nanometer process node. There is also anticipation that silicon wafers for the 2-nanometer process will cost 50% more. Additionally, with Apple reserving half of TSMC's 2-nanometer capacity, it might be impossible for Qualcomm and MediaTek to schedule enough production. Samsung Foundry and TSMC 2-nanometer process nodes also used gate-all-around transistors. With gate-all-around, the gate wraps entirely around the channel, reducing current leakage and boosting the driving current. Chips constructed employing gate-all-around transistors will show improved performance and utilize less energy. The first iPhone models to employ a 2-nanometer application processors should be next year's iPhone 18 series, which will feature the A20 and A20 application processors. So what will follow 2-nanometer? TSMC should launch mass production of 1.4-nanometer chips in 2028. However, TSMC will utilize a new naming method, which replaces nanometers with angstroms. 1 nanometer will equal 10 angstroms. The 1.4-nanometer process will consequently be referred to as A14. As for what comes after the 1.4-nanometer process node, A14, we could see a new transistor architecture and various materials used. So, if you enjoyed this video, please don't forget to give it a thumbs up and subscribe to our channel for more exciting tech news and updates. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you in the next one.